through multicellular animals, and in the body of the multicellular animals, millions of the cells are there, and these millions of the cells are grouped into four basic groups on their similarity in the structure and their function, and this basic group, these are called as tissues. Now the study of the cell, it is called as cytology, and the study of the tissue, it is known as histology. So the word histology, it is composed of two elements. So first is the histose and second one is the logos. So histose means tissue and logos means science or study or discourse. So it is simply the study of the tissue. Now question comes, what is tissue called, or what is tissue? So what is tissue? The tissue, it is a group of similar cells doing similar functions. So that is the tissue. So that is histology, that means the study of the tissue. Or histology, it is also called as microscopic anatomy, is that branch of anatomy in which the anatomical structure, it is studied with the help of the microscope. Yes? Yes, sir. So yeah, actually I have given auto options. So yes, all the students have joined. I have given auto option, they will automatically get admitted. Now the word histology, that is coined by the one of the anatomists, and that is called as A.F.J.K. Mayer. And this Mayer has coined the word histology. So Marie F.X. Bichat, he is called as a father of histology. Now, just I told you, the million cells of the body, these are grouped into four basic groups, and these are called as tissues. And these tissues of the body, this is also called as basic tissue, primary tissue, fundamental tissue, or elementary tissue. So because you take any cells of the body, that may be included in one of the four groups. That is the four basic groups. And because of that reason, so these are called as basic tissue. These are also called as primary tissue, or it is also called as fundamental or elementary tissues of the body. So these primary tissues are the epithelium, connective tissue, muscular tissue or muscles, and nervous tissue. So our body, it is made up of cells, and these similar cells, that is grouped into tissue, and this tissue, then it forms the organs of the body. And the organs of various organs that is meant for delivering a particular function, that comes together, and that from the system and various systems comes together, it forms the body of the animal. So that is the organization of the various organs in the body. So the basic primary tissues are epithelium, connective tissue, muscles, and the nervous tissue. Now we'll study first the epithelium. So now histology, just I told you, it is a study of the tissues. And this histology, it is again divided into two branches, that is the general histology and systemic histology. Now, general histology is that branch which mainly deals with the study of the structure of four fundamental tissues of the body. So whenever we go for the study of these four basic tissues, that comes under the general histology. Now, systemic histology is that branch, it mainly deals with the fine structure of the organs. So systemic histology, it is also called as organology, or it is also called as special histology. So these are the two branches of the histology. So out of these four primary tissues, we'll proceed to study the first basic tissue, and that is the epithelium. Now you look at the word epithelium, and this word epithelium, it is basically originate from the Latin language, and it is mainly composed of two components, epi and thelium. So meaning of the epi, that is means upon, and thelium means a nipple-like projection or a papilla of the connective tissue. So epithelium means it is that basic kind of the cells that is always located in the body on a papilla of a connective tissue or any nipple-like projections or a papilla of the connective tissue. So that is the name derived by this tissue, that is the epithelium. So whenever we study the microscopic structure of the epithelium, the epithelial cells or this tissue, it is always located on a papilla of the connective tissue. So that is the reason why it derives its name epithelium. Likewise. Now this epithelium mostly found in the free surfaces of the organs such as skin, trachea, intestine, etc. And this it is called as membranous epithelium. And the epithelium that is grouped together, the cells of the epithelium, it is grouped together to deliver the functions of secretion, excretion, that is called as glandular epithelium. So epithelium, it is broadly classified as membranous epithelium and glandular epithelium. So membranous epithelium that form a vast sheets membranes inside the body, just like serous membrane or mucous membrane. So these are the that forming the membranous type of the sheets or lamina, and that is called as membranous epithelium, while others it is called as glandular epithelium. Now the what is the main function of this epithelium, this primary tissue? So first and foremost function of the epithelium is the protection. So you see the our completely body externally it is covered by epithelium, membranous epithelium like skin, and internally the tubes of digestive system, respiratory system, urinary and genital system, these are also lined by mucous membrane. So our body is completely covered by mucus, skin, and internally lined by the mucous membrane, and thus it forms the protection. So it separates the body's internal environment, that is the blood, from the external environment and from the attack of the external injurious agents like bacteria, any parasites, etc., etc. So this powers of the protection by this epithelial cells is derived by the development of a protein keratin inside the their cytoplasm. So this protein keratin, it is a very tough hydrolytic, this is very tough enzyme or protein enzyme. So that is resistance to the various climatic agents, and this keratin does gives the power to this tissue that perform the power of the protection. So as this tissue covers the body surfaces and line the body cavities and tubes of the body, it also subject to wear and tear, and so continuously daily lot of cells or millions of the cells are lost from the body surface, and these are again replaced by highly dividing cells of the epithelium. So this protection, it is also facilitated by the epithelium. These are highly proliferative and they multiply in numbers by the mitotic cell division, and the increased number of the cell, they replace the lost cells or damaged cells or injured cells, and that is the reason why this epithelium retain the property of the protection of the body. Now the second function, that is the secretion. So various glands, intestinal gland, parotid salivary glands, gastric glands, intestinal glands, so they secrete some of the enzymes, juices, hormones, and that help in the digestion and various body processes. Now the third function, that is the absorption. So absorption of the various nutrients in the intestine, various micromolecules in the kidney, so that is mainly performed by the epithelial cell. So next function, that is the excretion. It is in intestine, so it excretes all or eliminate all the waste, metabolic waste product in the inside the urine, inside the sweat, inside the air that is expelled from the lung, and all these functions of the excretion, it is all done by the epithelial cell. Last function of the epithelium is the formation of the barriers. So barrier means a sheet. Beyond that, it is difficult for the microbes, bacteria, fungus, virus, etc. to cross that sheet. Or it is also difficult for other micromolecules to cross that sheet. So now intestine, in the lumen of the intestine, there is lot of this attacking agents like bacteria, microbe, parasites are there. But they cannot enter inside in our body because of a partition of the epithelial tissue which is there. So this partition of the epithelial tissue in the intestine and over the body surface, it form a barrier to prevent the entry of many organism inside the body, many nutrients in and outside the body, even in the urinary bladder. So highly concentrated urine it is there. So that will not absorb the body's fluid, tissue fluid that is present in the wall of the urinary bladder, because that cell, it forms the barrier there. So these are the functions of the epithelium, that is the formation of the barrier. Now we are talking about the epithelium. Now whenever we talk about the epithelium, the another name also coined with the epithelium is that basement membrane. So it is a pairing substance, basement membrane, that is always taught, or whenever we speak about the epithelium, the another word comes with it, that is the basement membrane. So the pairing words are just like husband, wife, sun, moon, positive, negative. So when we talk about the earth, or another word, that is the moon, comes along with that, earth, moon, likewise, husband, wife. So similarly, whenever we talk about the epithelium, the another word, it comes along with it, and that is the basement membrane. And it is equally important to deliver this, the function of the epithelium. So first we'll see what is basement membrane. So basement membrane, it is also called as membrana basalis. Now, Dr. Kalita already told you the cell, and the cell normally it is a, you see here it is a columnar cell, and this cell, columnar cell, it is having four surfaces. So this is the apical surface or luminal surface or free surface. This is the attached surface or basal surface, and these are the two lateral surfaces. So an epithelial cell, it is having four surfaces, apical, basal, and two lateral surfaces. Now this epithelial cell, it secretes some of the substances, that is combination of protein plus carbohydrate. And this combination of protein and carbohydrate, that is called as proteoglycans. So it is actually the sulfated heparans, are sulfated heparans. So these substances, complex type of the molecule, that is synthesized by this epithelial cell, and this epithelial cell secrete this proteoglycans along its basal border, and along its basal border it is secreted, and this substance then it is found along the basal surfaces of this all epithelial cell. Thus, after setting it hard, it form a platform, it form a sheet or lamina below the epithelial cell, on which the epithelial cell stand, on which the epithelial cell remains together, closely packed together. So this layer, this is a layer of the proteoglycans, it is called as basal lamina. So basal lamina, it is a layer or a sheet of the proteoglycans found along the basal border of the epithelial cells. And it anchors the epithelial cells to the underlying connective tissue, and it also forms a platform on which the epithelial cells stand. So for example, if you want to swim in the water, if you jump in the water, you will sink in the water. But if you take a wooden plank, and if you keep the wooden plank on the water or on the mud, and if you stand on that wooden plank, you will not go down, you will not sink, because you have taken the support that is strong enough that will prevent you from sinking into the water or mud. In the same way, this sheet, it is working, and this is called as basal lamina. So basal lamina, it is a layer or sheet located below the basal border of the epithelial cell, secreted by the epithelial cell, and it is mainly composed of proteoglycans. The proteoglycans, these are the laminin and fibronectin. So these two substances, they mainly form the proteoglycans, and that is secreted along the basal border, that is called as basal lamina. Now basal lamina, it is now a platform, a basement, that is strong enough to give support to the overlying epithelial cell. Now this epithelium, it is very stronger, that forming or that covering the surfaces of the body and lining the tubes of the various systems, and that remains anchored there, and thus prevent a breach for the external environment to enter inside the body. Likewise, so this basal lamina, it is formed by the epithelial cell by secreting substances like laminin and fibronectin along its basal border. Now this basal lamina, it is again made stronger. It is again reinforced by addition of some reticular fibers. And the layer in which the reticular fibers are present, that is called as reticular lamina. So both this layer, basal lamina plus reticular lamina, that form the basement membrane. So what is basement membrane? So basement membrane, it is composed of two layers, basal lamina plus reticular lamina. So basal lamina, it is mainly formed by proteoglycans, which are of laminin and fibronectin varieties. So this is the basement membrane, always seen in the microscope, usually under high powers. And this basement membrane, without basement membrane, epithelium cannot exist. At some places, like kidneys and lungs, sometimes the reticular lamina, so this layer is absent to carry out the function of the that particular organ. For example, in lungs, for oxygenation, exchange of the gases. So that to carry out the exchange of the gases, this layer it is absent. In kidney tubule, this layer it is absent. Only basal lamina it is present. And so the basal lamina, that is a part of the basement membrane, is always. And basement membrane, these are two pairing words. So whenever we talk of the epithelium, we should not forget to talk about the basement membrane. So that is the basement membrane that we have studied. Now we'll see what is the function of the basement membrane. Now the function of the basement membrane is, the primary function is to anchor down the epithelium to underlying both connective tissue. Or this epithelium, it is attached. Anchor down means it holds down the underlying basement membrane. So that remain, that gives support to remain at one place to this basement membrane. The second function, it provides structural support and polarity to the epithelial cell. So basement membrane, it provides support to this epithelium and also polarity to the epithelial cell. Polarity means having two ends, just like the earth, north pole, south pole, magnet, positive pole, negative pole. And similarly, a cell, it is having two poles, apical pole and basal pole. So you will see some organelles, cell organelles, these are highly concentrated at apical pole, while others are concentrated at basal pole. And so that forms the polarity, that gives polarity to the epithelial cell. Now, basal lamina component helps organize proteins in basal, in plasma membrane of epithelial cells, affecting endocytosis and signal transduction. So the process of drinking of a fluid by a cell, it is called as pinocytosis, phagocytosis, and eating substance, that is also called as endocytosis. So that is all facilitated by this basement membrane. Now basement membrane also essential for angiogenesis. So just I told you, the epithelium, it has a power of regeneration. So epithelial cell, it proliferates by the mitotic cell division. And while any part of the body get damaged, that part is healed and repaired. So during this process, this basement membrane is playing a role, important role in increasing the new blood vessels. Because the blood vessel itself, the cells of the blood vessel, that is the itself rest on the basement membrane. So that helps in the formation of the new blood vessel. Now protein of the basement membrane help to filter the substances entering the epithelium from below. Concentrate mitotic growth factor and help in epithelial repair and regeneration. So what are the protein part or component of the basement membrane? It is there. So this basement membrane, it is formed by proteoglycans, protein and combine with the carbohydrate moiety. So what this protein part that filter the substances entering the epithelium. Now just below the basement membrane, there is a lot of blood, tissue fluid it is there. And inside the tissue fluid, lot of nutrients are there. So it may just out of the body. And to prevent this, so they prevent and they filter the substances entering the epithelium from below. Now it also concentrated mitogenic growth factor. So during the process of proliferation, mitotic cell division takes place, and that also controlled by this basement membrane. It helps in epithelial repair and regeneration, just I told you, by replacing the old cells or lost cells. Basement membrane proteins also mediate cell-to-cell interaction and migration. So this is the different six functions of the basement membrane. Now I told you in kidneys and lungs, reticular lamina is absent. So basal lamina of podocyte cells in the kidney and alveolar cells in the lungs and the endothelial cells of the blood vessels, it unites together and they carry out the functions of filtration of the urine and gaseous exchange in the lungs respectively, likewise. So this is all about the basement membrane. So we have seen that the basement membrane is equally important for the epithelial cells to deliver its function. And without basement membrane, epithelium does not exist. So epithelium, one should know the structure. It is composed of two layers, basal lamina and lamina cellularis, and its function. Now, coming to the main point, that is the study of the epithelium. Now, epithelium, we have already studied that it is one of the basic tissue of the body. And it is completely covering our body externally, internally, thus protecting it from the external environment. So this epithelium, it is broadly classified as membranous epithelium and glandular epithelium. So membranous epithelium, it forms vast sheets like mucous membrane and serous membrane that lines the body cavities and also the tubes of the digestive, respiratory, and urogenital system. So this and glandular epithelium, it is located inside the glands like parotid salivary glands, sweat gland, etc. and etc. And that secretes some of the substances and that epithelium that is called as glandular epithelium. So epithelium, it is broadly classified as membranous epithelium and glandular epithelium. We'll proceed now to the study of the membranous or surface epithelium. Now this membranous or surface epithelium, it is classified on the shape of the cell. How the shape of the cell is as squamous or pyramidal epithelium, cuboidal epithelium, columnar epithelium. Now it is again classified as number of layers. So these cells, whether it is disposed of in one layer or it is disposed of many layers one above the other in layers. So that is called as simple epithelium and stratified epithelium. Simple epithelium, it is composed of one cell layer. While stratified epithelium, it is also called as compound epithelium, it is composed of many layers. So what stratum, it meaning a layer. Stratified means composed of many layers, layer over the layer. So some tissue is composed of many cells, one over the other, it is called as stratified. When it is a single layer, it is called as simple. When it is number of layers, it is called as stratified, stratum, layer over layer. So that is called stratified. Now another kind that is called as pseudo-stratified. So pseudo means false. So this pseudo-stratified epithelium, it gives the appearance of many cell layer, but it is only one cell layer thick. Now depending on both the criteria, that is the shape of the cell as well as number of cell layers, the epithelium is again classified as simple squamous, columnar and cuboidal epithelium, stratified squamous epithelium, stratified columnar epithelium and stratified cuboidal epithelium, pseudo-stratified epithelium and transitional epithelium. Now we'll see in detail the classification of these cells. Now depending on or based on the shape of the cell, now how the epithelium is classified. Now epithelium on the shape of the cell is classified as squamous, cuboidal and columnar depending upon the shape of the cell as squamous, tube-like and column-like, likewise. Now squamous epithelial cells, the cells will be thin, flat and scale-like, are irregular, pentagonal or hexagonal or even pyramidal in shape with slightly serrated border. So its lateral border, it is slightly serrated. The nucleus, it is located in the center of the cell and it may be spherical or oval. In the cross section, it shows that the cell, it is bulging in the region of the nucleus because it is bulged in the center because nucleus is present surrounded by a thin layer of this cytoplasm. So it is called as foramen. So you might have seen at your home, so in your hall, bedroom, you see the floor. The floor, it is covered by some of the pieces of the natural stone. So that is called as foramen. So for this cell, when it is observed from the surface, it has a similar shape to that of the pavement. Hence, it is also called as pavemental. So this shape of the cell, it may be quadrangular, it may be pentagonal, or it may be hexagonal, or it may be something irregular in shape with serrated border. And because of that reason, this epithelium derived its name as a simple epithelium. So this simple squamous epithelium, it is composed of one layer and it is squamous in shape or pavemental in shape. Now cuboidal epithelium, you see here the cubes. So here the cells are isodiametric, means we'll have equal width and height. You see the height of this cell and width of the cell, it is equal. And when height and width of the cells are equal, it form a cube-like structure. And when a particular cell, it has a structure of a cube, it is called as cuboidal. And these are the epithelial cells, it is called as cuboidal epithelium. Now, when the height of this cuboidal cell, it is increased than width, so the shape of the cell, it becomes column-like, a pillar-like. And because of that reason, these cells are called as columnar epithelium. So columnar epithelium consists of tall, narrow cells with greater height than width. They are columnar in shape. Nuclei are oval and are located in the center or near the base of the cell. So you see the nucleus. So nucleus are oval or it is spherical, usually located in the center of the cell. But when the cell assume the polarity, means polar polarity, some organs are accumulated near the apical border and some are near the basal border. So then nucleus comes down the basal, near the basal border. It may be due to the pressure of the various cell organelles that pushing the nucleus to the basal surface or the basal border. So this is all about the columnar epithelial cell. Now we'll see how the epithelium is classified on number of cell layer or how many stratum it is composed of. So simple epithelium, it is composed of single layer of the cell. It is adapted for absorption and secretory role. When the epithelium it is disposed of in a single layer, so it has to do different functions like absorption in the intestine, absorption of the nutrients, vitamins, minerals, and various complex and simple micromolecules of the food material that is performed by this epithelium, and to have easy access to absorption and transmitting it to the body fluid or blood. So it has this arrangement. And at this place, the epithelial cells are disposed of into single cell layer. And it is because of that reason, it is one cell layer thick. It is called a simple epithelium. So stratified epithelium or compound epithelium, it is more than one cell layer thick. It protects against the mechanical and chemical action. So this is a use of stratified epithelium, how many layers it is composed of. And main reason it is that it protects the body from the mechanical and chemical actions like this. Now, next variety is pseudostratified columnar epithelium. So here, there are two figures are there, above simple columnar and at the bottom, there is pseudostratified columnar epithelium. So the word pseudo means fall. So this is a epithelium. If you look at this epithelium, it is composed of many layers of the cell. But actually, when it is observed under the microscope, it is only one cell layer thick. Now this pseudostratified epithelium, it is composed of a single layer of columnar cells, which are of different in height. Some cells are taller while others are shorter. Look at this diagram. Some cells are taller and others are shorter. So you see at this cell, how it is shorter. This is also shorter and this is taller cell. The nucleus of all these cells are located in the center of the cell. So whatever may be the height, it is there. So nucleus of all these cells, it is located in the center of this cell. All these cells rest on basement membrane, but not all of them reaches to the apical or luminal surface. To look at this cell, all the cells, they are resting on the basement membrane here, but their top end or apical free surface is not reaching here up to the free surface or the luminal surface. Likewise, so when arrangement it is like that, when it is observed under the microscope, the nuclei are seen located at different layers, gives the appearance that the tissue is composed of many layers. As it gives false impression of many layers, it is termed as pseudostratified columnar epithelium. So this is the use, this kind of the epithelium, it is one cell layer thick, but as some cells are taller and some cells are shorter, the nucleus are located in the center, and it gives, as taller cell nucleus, when the cell is taller, the nucleus is located at upper level. When the cell is shorter, the nucleus is located at lower level, and it gives the impression that there are many, this tissue is composed of many cell layers thick, and it gives the false impression, and it is called as pseudostratified columnar epithelium. Now this is the third category of the classification of the epithelium, where both the properties are combined together, the shape and number of cell layers. And depending upon that, or based on that, the shape and the number of cell layer, the epithelium is classified as simple squamous epithelium. So simple squamous epithelium, the simple name, it is stand for one layer, one cell layer thick, and squamous, another name, it is stand for the shape of the cell. So simple squamous epithelium, it is a pyramidal epithelium, which is one cell layer thick. Single layer of flat, irregular squamous cell, pentagonal or hexagonal in shape with slightly serrated border. The cell rests on basement membrane. In the center is a spherical or oval nucleus is there. Simple squamous epithelium along with underlying connective tissue form the vast serous membrane of the body. So here one diagram, it is there. So this is, you see, so this is a diagram of a blood vessel, microscopic structure of a blood vessel. It is composed of three layers from outside inward, you see. So innermost layer, it is of squamous cell, and this squamous cell, it rests on the basement membrane. And this is the simple squamous epithelial cell that lines the blood vessels of the body. It is all blood vessels of the body. Now locations, where this epithelium is present inside the body. So this simple squamous epithelium, it lines the serous membrane of the body, and this serous membrane, which is located in the thorax, it is called as pleura. In the abdomen, it is called as peritoneum, and in the when it surrounds the heart, that is called as pericardium. So this same serous membrane, it is that, but it is named differently in different body cavities. And this serous membrane, it is lined by simple squamous epithelium, and that is called as mesothelium. So the name meso, that indicates its origin. So this meso means mesoderm, embryonic origin. So embryonic germ layers are three: ectoderm, mesoderm, and endoderm. So epithelium originates from all the three germ layers. So this kind of epithelium that arises from the embryonic mesoderm, so it is called as mesothelium. Now another example or occurrence of the simple squamous epithelium in the body. So all the blood vessels inside the body, that is the lymphatic vessels or the blood vessels, vein, artery, etc., all are lined by a simple squamous epithelium that is called as endothelial cell. And this endothelium, it is nothing but a simple squamous epithelium originating from the embryonic endoderm. So that is called as endothelium. So endothelium, it is the epithelium arising from embryonic endoderm. So the name endothelium. Now alveoli of the lung and respiratory bronchiole of the lung contains simple squamous epithelium. At renal corpuscle, so that is both podocyte as well as the parietal portion are all simple squamous epithelium. Inner surface of the eardrum, that is the tympanic membrane, membranous labyrinth of internal ear, anterior chamber of the eye, it is all are lined by simple squamous epithelium. So these are the many places where the simple squamous epithelium occur in the body. Now simple cuboidal epithelium. So it is a cuboidal shaped cell, but it is composed of one cell layer. So the simple cuboidal epithelium consists of single layer of cuboidal cell. Cells are isodiametric. So here the diagram, it is shown here, the one cell layer thick, and the cells are equal in height and equal in weight. The nucleus, it is located in the center of the cell. Now here this kind of the epithelium present in the body. So it is present in the thyroid follicles, and many small ducts of the exocrine gland, collecting duct of kidney. It also covers the choroid plexus of the brain ventricles. So there are choroid plexuses in the ventricles of the brain. So that choroid plexus, it is also covered by this simple cuboidal epithelium. It is also found in the ciliary body of the eye and anterior epithelium of the lens of the eye. So this is all different locations where the simple cuboidal epithelium is located. Now, simple columnar epithelium, single layer of columnar cell. The diagram shows that you see all the cell resting on basement membrane, and this is other simple columnar epithelial cell. So location, it lies the organs that perform the absorptive function and secretion. So mainly absorption of the various food material take place in the intestine, small and large, and it is all lined by the simple columnar epithelium. Secretion at many glands. So it secretes, that cell secretes something, and it is lined by simple columnar epithelium. Our stomach, glandular stomach, or the gastric glands are also lined by the simple columnar epithelium. Even the true stomach, it is lined by simple columnar epithelium. Gallbladder, vesicular gland, bulbourethral gland in case of the male, uterus in case of the female, in some species, it is all lined by simple columnar epithelium. Now, fourth variety, that is called a pseudostratified columnar epithelium. Just I have explained pseudostratified. So pseudostratified columnar epithelium, in this type, all the cells rest on basement membrane, but not all of them reaches the apical or the luminal surface. Those cells that reaches the surface are either ciliated or non-ciliated or goblet cells. So look at this diagram here. So this is the pseudostratified columnar epithelium. So all the cells are resting on the basement membrane here, but not all of them are reaching to this pre-surface or the apical surface. Now some are reaching the apical surface or pre-surface. And those who are reaching to the apical surface, some cells bear the small microscopic hair-like structures on the apical surface, that is called a cilia. And so this is called a ciliated cell, while other it is called as non-ciliated cell. So non-ciliated cell, it may secrete the mucus, and that is called as, it slightly assume a form of a globe, and so it is called as goblet cells. So that may secrete mucus, and it is a single cell, so it is called as unicellular mucus gland. So uni means one, it is composed of one cell that secretes the mucus, and it is called as unicellular mucus gland. So these are the pseudostratified columnar epithelium, it is here. Now where is this type of the tissue it is located? So this kind of the pseudostratified columnar epithelial cell, it occurs or it is located in the trachea, bronchi, and in some parts of the male reproductive tract like epididymis and vas deferens. The oviduct in some species of the domestic animal, it is also lined by pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelial cell. So this is all about the pseudostratified columnar ciliated epithelium. Now this is all we have seen, that simple epithelium. Now we will study the stratified epithelium. Just I told you, stratified means this kind of the tissue, it is composed of many layers, one layer above the another layer. Now this, it is consisted of stratified squamous epithelium, stratified cuboidal epithelium, stratified columnar epithelium, then transitional epithelium, etc. Now first we will study the stratified squamous epithelium. Look at the diagram. So this is the stratified squamous epithelial cell. And very good example of the stratified squamous epithelium, it is the skin of the body. So you see the how many layers. So this is the basement membrane where the epithelium rests. And this is the papilla of the connective tissue that I told you. So epithelium always rests on the papilla of the connective tissue. And just over the connective tissue, there is thin membrane, that is called as basement membrane, where the epithelium attaches to this basement membrane. And this basement membrane attaches this epithelial cell with the underlying connective tissue. So this is all holding to one another. So all these structures are holding to one another, making the integrity of the body, or making the integrity of that particular epithelium. Now you see, for the stratified squamous epithelium consists of several layer of cells. The most superficial cell being squamous. You see, the superficial cells are being squamous or pyramidal in shape. The lower layer can be a polyhedral columnar in shape, just proliferated by mitosis. There are two types of the stratified squamous epithelium, keratinized one and non-keratinized one. So you see, look at the diagram, you see the cell which are resting on the basement membrane, these are tall columnar cells. Now the cell is second layer, third layer, so you see it is polyhedral in shape. So in this polyhedral shape, again when it passes upward, so it becomes slightly elongated, flattened, and these cells are elongated, flattened. And again, when cell pushes upward in the topmost layer, that is called as at the surface of the skin, the cell become very flat and the cell become dead, and complete protoplasmic mass of this basal cell, columnar cell, it is slowly converted into a dead unit of the protein keratin. So this is the surface cells. These are the simply dead cells having the packets of the macroscopic packets of the protein keratin. So keratin, it is a very resistant protein to many environmental factors, and thus it protects the body from many destructive factors of the environment, and thus it forms the structure of the skin. So this epithelium, it may be keratinized and it may be non-keratinized one. So keratinized form, which has a cells on the surface layer that have lost the nuclei and filled with the protein keratin, as in the skin. So in the skin, what happens? The cells which is located on the basement membrane, they are alive. But as they move away from the basement membrane, so they become dead. So you see the blood vessels are not present inside the epithelium. The epithelium, it is avascular and closely packed cell. So there is no blood vessel inside the epithelial cell. As you move away from the blood vessel, nutrition, there is a slowly process exists, that is the dying off. The cells die off, this epithelial cell die off as it moves from the basal layer to the apical cell. And the cells in the basal layer, these are living cells having nucleus, and the cells in the superficial layer, these are the dead cells with no nuclei and simply packets of protein keratin. So when the keratin is present in the superficial layer, such epithelium, it is called as keratinized epithelium. While non-keratinized form, where the superficial cells retain their nuclei, as in oral mucosa. So same kind of the epithelium that lines the some parts or some organs of the digestive system, like mouth cavity, esophagus in some species. So where the tissue is composed of stratified epithelium with nucleus in the superficial cell layer. So the cells are not dead at the superficial layer. All the cells are living. All the cells are living. The superficial cell is having protein keratin, but the nuclei are present and the cells are living cells. They slowly lose their power of regeneration as they move from basal border to the apical surface, likewise. And so this is called as non-keratinous form present in oral mucosa and many other parts. So this is the stratified squamous epithelium. The name squamous, it is given to this tissue because the surface cell look squamous in shape, pyramidal in shape. Now this stratified squamous epithelium, it is mainly composed of 3 to 5 distinct cell layer. And these cell layers, from outside inward or from superior surface to the deeper surface, are, this is stratum corneum, then this one is stratum lucidum, below that is a stratum granulosum, below that is a stratum spinosum, and this lowermost that is a stratum basale. So this stratum basale, it is also called as stratum germinativum because it germinates the new epithelial cell. So these cells of the basal layer, it is highly mitotic. They proliferate, increases in number by the process of cell division. Of cell division, mitosis, the increased number of cells, which is pushed upward in the superficial layer. And these cells, increased number of the cell passes upward, and they come to the superficial layer, where the superficial cells are daily lost in individual number, and they are replacing by newly formed epithelial layers. So these are the different layers. So the lowermost layer, that is one cell layer, can be formed in shell in shell. It contains highly mitotic figure. It also contains some pigment forming cells like melanocytes, etc. 1 in 10 normal cells, and that form the various kinds of the pigments coloration to the skin. So stratum spinosum, it is cell layer thick. So that is located above this stratum basally. Now the stratum granulosum, it is 3 to 5 cell layer thick. So when the cells from the stratum spinosum move upward, enter into the stratum granulosum. As name indicates, stratum is a layer. Cell contains some granules, and these granules are the keratohyaline granules. So that is the precursor of the protein keratin. So when it is the keratohyaline granules accumulate inside the cell, so this cell layer, it is called stratum granulosum. When these cells move upward into the upper layer, this is called stratum lucidum. Complete keratinized, this protein keratinized, it becomes semi-transparent like a glass. And lucidum is a transparent one, a layer that is a transparent one, a cell layer that is a transparent one. So it is the name given, stratum lucidum. And a cell from this moves in the uppermost layer. This uppermost layer, it is 5 to 7 cell layer thick, and it is named as stratum corneum. So corneum means it contains, really the corn means, cornus means horn, Latin word cornus is horn. So it is as tough as the horn, as tough as the stone. So this, and this cell layer, topmost cell layer, it is really hard due to the protein keratin. So this is all the epithelium, that is called a stratified squamous epithelium. It is mainly forming the epidermis of the skin, and the thickness of the epidermis of the skin mainly depends on the epidermis and not on the dermis. So in some animal, you see, the skin is thick. So in case of cow, it is less thick. In case of elephant, it is more thick. In case of rhino, it is more thicker. And this thickness of the epithelium, it is mainly due to the thickness of epidermis. So even in the same animal, the skin, which is located on the dorsal surface, dorsal aspect of the body, it is thicker than the skin is located on the ventral aspect of the body. So this is in short of the stratified squamous epithelium. And this is the occurrence, that is, or location where this stratified squamous epithelium is located inside the body. Now here the diagram is shown here. So there is a very beautiful diagram. So you see, our body of the animal, it is completely covered by the skin. And this is the only one system which is having both the ends open. So this is digestive or elementary canal. It extends from the mouth up to the anus. So this system, it opens at both the end on both surfaces. So anteriorly it opens to the external surface by the way opening, that is called as rima oris, to mouth, and posteriorly to anus, likewise. And so what is the lumen of this elementary canal or digestive tube that contains all the material, microbes, flora that may be beneficial or harmful to the body, and that act as an external environment of the body. Though it is located, though these organs are located inside the body, but it's the external environment. So internal environment means blood. So it is separated from the blood by this barrier of the epithelial cell here. So this is all about the, while the other system like urinary system, respiratory system, male and female genital system. So of the four system, only one end, it is open on the body surface. These are the just like a blind lane or blind systems. Only one end is open and another end is blind. So, but digestive system, it has two ends, both over the body surface, and all these systems are lined internally by a mucous membrane. And this mucous membrane, it is a part of the epithelium that forms the body. So, complete external surface and internal surface of the body, it is lined the epithelium, thus causes the protection of the body. Now the next variety is the stratified cuboidal epithelium. So in this type, there are two or more layers of the cuboidal cells are there. So cuboidal cells, these are tube-shaped, and these are located in more than two layers. So locations, excretory duct of the sweat gland and cell lining antrum of the ovarian. These are very good example here. The stratified tubular epithelium is located. Now next variety, that is called stratified columnar epithelium. So the stratified columnar epithelium, it is very rarely present inside the body. So there will be two layer of the columnar cell. One superficial, being columnar in shape. So out of these two layer, superficial layer, it is columnar in shape. And lower layer, deeper layer, it may be columnar or it may be cuboidal in shape. And the name of this epithelium, it is mainly derived from its shape of the superficial layer. And so this is a stratified columnar epithelium. It is very rarely found inside the body and very few locations it is located. Now, where are those locations? So this stratified columnar epithelium, it is found at the junction of oropharynx with the nasopharynx. So here the epithelium jump from simple columnar to the stratified one. And at this junction, at this juncture, the epithelium, it is of this variety, stratified columnar. So it is also present in penile urethra. So urethra, it is part of, composed of two portions, pelvic urethra, the part of urethra located in the pelvic cavity, and the part of urethra located inside the penis, that is called as penile urethra. And this penile urethra that extends from the ischial arch of the tip of the glans penis, it is lined by stratified columnar epithelium. Next example, excretory duct of some salivary glands in some species. Palpebral conjunctiva in horse and dog, it is lined by stratified columnar epithelium. So these are very few examples where stratified columnar epithelium, it is located inside the body. Now next epithelium, that is the transitional epithelium. So transitional means changing from one phase into another phase. So this epithelium, so it has a different stages of its shape. So when in one state or one phase it is formed in different shape, and in another stage or phase it is formed in different stage or phase. So transition means transferring from one phase into another phase. For example, many times you look at the sky during night, so how the moon is changing its phase from Amavasya to Purnima, or from full moon to the half moon, likewise. So how the moon, it is changing phases, and that is not fixed. So that is called a transition. So transition means changing from one phase into another. So similarly, this kind of the epithelial cell, so that is changing its phases or shape, and that is the reason that is called as transitional epithelium. So this type of the epithelium, it is multilayer or it is stratified. It acts as a barrier. Shape of the cells changes depending upon the pressure exerted by urine, and the cells are elastic and are capable of distension without any damage. Now you see here this type kind of the epithelium that is located inside the urinary bladder and adjacent part of ureter and urethra. And that is the reason it is called as urothelium, because it is located inside the urinary bladder. Now you know that when the urinary bladder is empty, it is about the size of a fish, and slowly form inside the kidney, brought to urinary bladder by ureter, and slowly urine accumulate inside the urinary bladder. It is just like a balloon like pouch bag where urine is stored temporarily. So when the urine is slowly filled up with urine, so its wall get distended. So the urine exert pressure on the inner layer or the mucosa of the urinary bladder. So when the urinary bladder get full of the urine, so this cell, which is composed of many cell layers, it is now you see in the diagram, it is composed of two cells and so when the urinary bladder is distended and it is full of the urine distended, and this seventh layer, it is the tooth layer. So the shape changes from this rounded in cell to a flat one. The cell which is located, these are the cuboidal cells. So then next layer is polygonal cell. These are larger than the basal layer, and these are polygonal in shape. And the cells which line the lumen of the urinary bladder, these are rounded cell, very bigger cell. So because they are high when urine with the urine, these cells are highly elastic. They can elongated to that much extension. without any damage to that particular cell. And this is the structure, and this cell slowly changes its or shape from empty urinary bladder to full urinary bladder. That is why it is named as. So the surface epithelial cells, these are pillow shaped, the like a pillow, and so these are called as pillow shaped cells. These are the large rounded epithelial cells on the smaller cells are located in the basal layer, and that gives the property of the elasticity like a rubber band to this epithelial tissue. Depending on the pressure of the urine inside the urinary bladder, it can contract and it can elongate, and that is the reason. Called transitional epithelium present in the urinary bladder and adjacent part of ureter. In some domestic animals and other animals, these are also present in two locations. Usually, it is a tissue of the urinary bladder. The shape of the cell depends on the degree of distension of urinary bladder. When urinary bladder is full, the cell becomes flattened, and when it is empty, the cell becomes rounded or pillow shaped. Just told you the process. Why it is called a transitional epithelium. So this is the diagram that show the different types of the epithelium, simple and stratified one. Stratified, but you use all the appearance of being composed of many layers. So it is called a pseudo stratified epithelium. And by this, you have completed this topic, that is the membranous epithelium. In next class, next Saturday, there will be class on membranous epithelium. Now the topic is open for discussion. If anyone is having any difficulty on any topic relating to this, please ask. The topic is open.
Sir, very nicely elaborated. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yes, dear student, any difficulty? Membrane, its function. Please ask. Are you hearing me, students? Praveen?
Yes, sir.
Praveen?
Yes, sir.
Any difficulty?
No, sir.
Juliet, any difficulty?
No, sir.
So it seems that our students are very clever, they don't have any difficulty. Today's class is over. Okay, good day. We'll meet next Saturday at 11 o'clock. Bye. Good day.
Thank you, sir.
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 Bye. Good day.